We'll start the class with three ohms and a prayer. Om sahana bhavato sahanau bhunaktu saha viryam karavavahai tejasvinavadhitamastu ma vidvishavahaihi Om shanti shanti shantihi. So we continue our study of this beautiful text, Atmabodha, by Shankaracharya, in which Shankaracharya teaches us how to differentiate between the body, mind, and Atma. This is a very clear exercise of 68 verses, teaching us how I can know this Atma? How can I de-link with my body and mind? That is the goal of this text. What will happen if I know how to de-link? The sorrows which I experience in my life will become less dominant. That is the basic advantage of knowing this Atma. And all of us have this basic desire to get rid of sorrow and to attain happiness. So this text is written for those people who are desirous of removing sorrow from their life and attaining happiness. We are in verse number 38, which is in the middle of this text, which is talking about how do I assimilate this knowledge of Atma. This process is called as internalization. After this, we are going to study how do I meditate. A few verses are on meditation. So with this small introduction, let me go straight to verse number 38, which we will start today. Vivikta desha asino virago vijitendriyaha. Whenever we talk about meditation, we always talk about a place where to meditate. In the last three verses, as you know, which we did in the last class, 35, 36, and 37, there were several indicators teaching us about Atma. Those three verses, I said, is the most important verses in this text. Because we must keep those three verses in our mind, not only while studying this particular text, but also while studying any other spiritual text written by Shankaracharya or the Gita or the Upanishads. The goal of all our learning is only Atma. And the more we learn about Atma, the more we will be able to draw ourselves from Anatma. Anatma means our body, mind, sense organs, and the universe. These are the four things we should remember. Whenever we say Anatma, Anatma means not Atma. So in our mind, we should have a new division of the world. One, I the Atma. Second, the whole universe, which is Anatma, consisting of, that means I push my body, my mind into the universe. Then only it becomes complete for doing this inquiry. As long as you think yourself as the body or as the mind, you will never get a right picture of this universe. This is an extremely important point to know. If I want to do the inquiry about myself, I must know that I am something different than the body. The body is inert, but there is something in the body which is sentient, which is making this body alive. So my inquiry or my destination is to know what is this sentiency, what is this life principle in this body, which makes me talk, which makes you hear, which makes me walk, which makes you run. All the activities are done with some power in this body. In order to know this power in us, in this particular verse, Shankaracharya says that we must first sit in a calm place, because we need to free our mind from all the agitations in the form of desires, in the form of plans, actions which we want to do, in the form of anxieties in the mind, in the form of different emotions in the mind. So we need to keep the mind away from all this. Therefore, a secluded place is recommended. So the process of meditation mainly consists of two things. One is the control of senses, and the second is the control of the mind. After having controlled the mind and the senses, then what do we do? Then we need to meditate on the Atma. This is the process of meditation which I have been teaching in the last six sessions. Today is the seventh session of meditation. So every time, what I'm trying to learn is to get away or control my sense organs by closing the sense organs. Then freeing the mind, that means I won't be able to free the mind completely. The mind is something which is always will come and go, but I will be able to relatively quieten my mind. By chanting Om, by chanting some mantra, some exercises I do, I just decrease the speed of my mind. And what are the main problems we have in life? Number one is all the relationships with the world. So in the seat of meditation, I tell myself I am asangaha. Asangaha means I'm not attached to anything in the creation. As Atma, as body, I am always attached. As mind, I am always attached. Here in the seat of meditation, I learn about Atma, which is free from this entire body-mind complex. One of the natural emotions we all have is the fear of death. We see so much of death around us, and we also feel that I also will die. Therefore, in meditation, I learn to claim that portion of mine which is deathless. Therefore, I say to myself, I am Nityaha. Nityaha means something which is beyond time. So there are two things. One is the world in time and space, and the second is something which is timeless. So I say I am that timeless principle, not that the principle with time and space. Old memories will come like bubbles in meditation. It's only through abhyasa or practice we can control those memories. We need to be absorbed in the Atma, which was described in verses 33, 34, and 35. Normally, when we sit in meditation, our mind will be preoccupied. This is a natural tendency of the mind. We should recognize this natural tendency. The mind will not ask our permission. Can I think about my friend? Can I think about the yoga program which is going on today? Can I think about what I need to cook? No, it just automatically comes in meditation. That is called as the preoccupation of the mind. We need to assert the mind that the cause of happiness or sorrow is the mind itself. And if I learn more about Atma, which is free from the mind, I will be a wise man, wise person. There are two eyes which we entertain, or which we can entertain. One is the ignorant eye, which I am naturally am, which is called as the ego eye. This ego eye is the source of all sorrow. World, body, mind are always experienced in time and space. But there is something which is beyond time. In time and space, we will always have problems. We cannot say that I will be in the waking state and there will be no problems. But the scripture says that there is a wise eye. In the same body, there is another eye. The more I learn about this Atma eye, then I can know that this Atma eye is the real source of happiness. And it is of the nature of consciousness, and it is beyond the time-space principle. That is what Shankaracharya wants to teach us in this particular verse. He says that Atma is one without a second. With unswerving attention, we meditate. Why do we say without a second? Because Atma is only one. When you meditate on Atma and I sit in my house and meditate on Atma, we are both meditating on the same principle. It's like saying there's only one God in the whole universe. Whether you talk, you pray to your God, I pray to my God, it's the same one principle, which is called God principle. So what the scriptures tell us is that there is one principle which is there in this entire universe, and which is the substratum, or which is the entire cause for the entire universe. So meditating on that one Atma will free my mind from all the worries. That is the essence of this verse, number 8, 38. Then we move on to 39. Here the example of space is taken, and it says that space is never contaminated. We need to understand the Atma, in spite of so many thoughts we have had in our life, Atma still remains pure, untouched with all the sorrows we have had in life, untouched with all the problems we have had in life, the ups and downs in life, the emotions which we had in life, that Sakshi or the illuminating principle has not changed at all in this body. So, the wise one should intelligently merge the entire world of objects. This tells us how I should meditate. And what do I do in meditation? I bring the entire universe and say this whole universe comes in the waking state and then it goes off in the sleep state. Again, it comes in the morning, again it goes off. But I, the experiencer, or I, the consciousness principle, which is the seer of this world, has not changed. I, the seer, am uncontaminated like the space. When I say I, it is not the body, it is not the mind, it is the consciousness principle. That is the teaching in this verse. If you see throughout this exercise of Atmabodha or any other texts, we will always be talking of these two I. One I is called as Aham, another I is called as Ahamkara. These are two Sanskrit names. Aham means I without the mind and the body. Ahamkara means the same I with the body and mind. Throughout, even when you study any other scriptures, it will be the same exercise. All verses will be talking about the same discrimination. So here, the space is never contaminated. That's what this verse says. And I, the Atma, am blemishless, exactly like the space. All the things are accommodated in space. You have foul air, you have pure air. All this all belongs to the property of air, but not to the space. Space is always the same. It never is pure or impure. It is always the same. Similarly, Atma is always the same in spite of all the states of experiences which we have. What is the relationship between me and the world? If I am the observer, the world is the observed. So, as an observer, I am the only substance. And the world is what? It's only name and form. The observer is the same in the past, in the present, and in the future. The world keeps on changing. The world is ever in motion. And the observer remains the same, is never in motion. Similarly, now let's understand what is Atma and the Veka. Atma is the substance behind the waking world. Waking world's existence, a waking world rising, and waking world's resolution. And the waker is what? The waker is the substratum of the dream. The dream world's existence, the dream world rising, the dream world resolution. So the comparison is done between Atma and the waker. So for the dream, waker is the substratum or the substance. For the waker, Atma, the pure consciousness, is the substratum. So this is what we are learning in verse number 38 and 39. Like we say, water is the content behind the wave and ocean. Behind the world, pure consciousness is the content. Behind the ring and the bangle, the content is the goal. So what is ring, bangle, or chain? They are all appearances of one substance. This entire world is nothing else but an appearance of the pure consciousness. It is the same pure consciousness. I, the pure consciousness, am appearing as this body as well as the world. And where is this awareness located? There is no location for awareness because it is timeless and it is spaceless. It is beyond time, beyond space. But the objects like the body, mind, the world of objects, they are all located in time and space. But the awareness principle is locationless. See, these are all the different forms in which Shankaracharya is teaching us how to distinguish Atma and Anatma. So the and this is a very simple text without many jargons and so on in which we find in other texts. That this is a very simple basic text for beginners to learn about Atma and to learn how to disidentify with the Anatma. When I look at the pure existence, it appears as the world and it appears as I. This is what I said just now. The I is with three components. This is how we try to understand the whole universe. These are all diagrams just to explain what we are experiencing. And they are Shankaracharya divides all this into different components so that the intellect can slowly differentiate between the mind, the world, and the gross body, the five koshas, and then how to differentiate that with Atma. This is a very, very subtle study which we are doing. So the eye has got a reflected material, which are the three bodies, the gross body, subtle body, and the causal body. And these three bodies have a reflection of consciousness. And pure consciousness is the real substance behind this entire universe. So this diagram we keep on thinking about in our own mind. A day will come when I will be able to say, I am that pure Atma. The purpose of study is only for ultimately convincing our own intellect that I am that pure consciousness principle. The oneness which we talk about is only with reference to the consciousness, with reference to the water content behind the wave and ocean, behind the individual jiva and the total Lord. There is one content, one substance, which is called as consciousness. So never try to link and never try to say that in the waking state, how do I see, how do I perceive oneness? In the waking state, you cannot perceive the oneness because the waking state is full of divisions. My eyes are designed to see Dvaitam. But through the knowledge of the scriptures, I get a special eye. That special eye can reveal the oneness. That is why scriptures are extremely important in our study. We cannot take another text of physics or anything else to study the subject consciousness. There's nothing, I mean, it will not reveal. Only going through these type of scriptures, which are designed for the study of the subject in us, will help us to understand our real nature. We move on to the next 40th verse. What happens if one has studied and one who has realized this Atma? The benefit is being shown here. And he says, he who has realized the Supreme will drop his identification with name and form. And then what will happen? He becomes the self itself. Because knowing Atma is, they say, is being Atma. Because you become Atma. There is nothing called as knowing and not becoming. This is because it happens to be the subject. This is a subjective science. When I learn that Atma, I become because I am that subject. Our bondage is with reference to the body and mind, with reference to the seen, the observed phenomena in the universe. And liberation means whatever is unseen, what lends existence to this body and mind. That is what, if I come to know, then I can say I am liberated. Seeing the five koshas, seeing the three bodies is bondage. Seeing the oneness, the pure awareness, is liberation. In Atma, there is no, it lacks nothing. It is full, it is complete. In Dvaitam or in the five koshas, we will always have differences. In meditation, we learn to negate the differences which we observe in the Dvaitam field, in the field of transactions. And we learn to assert that I am that Atma. So that is the teaching in the 40th verse. Again, these are all telling us how I can sit in meditation and contemplate on these points. When my mind contemplates in these points, what happens is the mind gets the additional power. When the mind gets that additional power, it is called as jnana chakshuhu. The intellect becomes very powerful because we are using the scriptures to see the world which my eyes cannot see. So what happens when we do that is explained in this verse. There are no distinctions in Atma. The knower, knowledge, and the object of knowledge, this is called as Triputi in Vedanta. Knower means the ahamkara, the ego I. In the waking state, it says, I see the world. In the dream state, it sees the dream world. In the sleep state, it just is ignorant about the world. So in all the three states, there are objects for this knower. This knower is the ahamkara, which is the reflected consciousness together with the mind. We must remember that the definition of Atma or Sakshi is without the mind. The definition of ahamkara is always with the mind. So the self is pure bliss. It's independently existing. It's not identified with the, it's not objectified with the thoughts as the subject. It is always an object. Thoughts are always objects of the self, objects of the consciousness principle. So I am Atma, that thought is entertained is to negate other thoughts of limitations. In the seat of meditation, they recommend that instead of thinking about the memories of some person, memories of some past events, slowly I train my mind and say, I am Sakshi. I am pure consciousness. Deliberately, we bring these words in our mind. By doing that, what happens is this Sakshi does not have the object. It doesn't have the object of, like the ahamkara has an object of the world. Aham does not have an object. When we say aham Sakshi, aham Nityaha, I am eternal, what happens is this is a word without any object. Objectless awareness is called as consciousness. So the mind is trained to see or experience that objectless consciousness. what happens to ahamkara, the ego, the other side? Whenever we look at the world, there is the knower, knowledge, and the object of knowledge. Object could be something which was in the past, I'm recollecting. Object can be something which is coming in the future. Suppose I start sitting in meditation and start thinking about what I'm going to do tomorrow. So that is an object which will be in the future. So to see a clip, there is a clip thought which is required. To see my friend in meditation or to see the Lord in meditation, the thought is required. Those are all with gunas. That means they are all objects. Whereas Atma is Nityaha. And this Atma is what is called as immortal. Because in this Atma, there is no time. Time does not affect the core of our personality. Remember this always, whenever we are in worry, whenever we feel sad, remember this quality of our own true nature. When we remember this, what will happen is, immediately we will know that whatever I am thinking is a mind's thought. It's a thought in the mind. And this has got a lot of practical benefits. Immediately I become aware. Immediately I know how I can drop my thoughts, I can drop my emotions. These are the practical benefits of the knowledge of Atma. The next topic, the fifth topic, we have finished four topics so far. The last topic, the fifth topic of this text is from verse number 42 to verse number 68. And in these verses, what Shankaracharya teaches us is the benefit of this knowledge. Just now I was telling you the benefit, one of the main benefits of this knowledge is to know my mind. It's not to know others' mind, but to know my own mind. That is because I am looking at the mind as Atma, as the Sakshi. As we learn to practice these meditations, which I have so far taught in the last six sessions, we will learn for sure to distance ourselves from the mind. The mind's impurities are the one which brings sorrows in life to us. And the more we are able to distance ourselves from the mind, the more we are able to handle the problems of life. 42nd verse talks about the lower and the higher aspects of the self. When we say lower aspect, it is called as ahamkara, which is the mind with I. Higher aspect means it is the same I but without the mind. In the process of meditation, what we do, we turn the upper higher I with the lower I. So when I'm contemplating, what happens is there's a churning process going on, like how we bring out the fire in the olden days when they were doing yajnas or rituals, fire rituals. They used to just rub two blocks of wood to create the fire. So that example is being taken here, and it says that the way we bring out the fire by churning the two wooden blocks, similarly, the knowledge of Atma rises like the fire. When I contemplate on Atma and Anatma. A beautiful example taken out by Shankaracharya, because during those times, the rituals and the Agni rituals were very popular. And so this, he says, that the spark of knowledge of Atma is ignited. then we churn our mind, but we must be very careful. We must churn the mind with reference to the things which we have learned in the three verses before. Atma being Nityaha, Nirgunaha, you know, those one or two, three, four qualities we take, and then we rotate that in our mind. That churning is what is called as is contemplation or meditation. The benefit of this knowledge is I am free from the identification with the body, mind and intellect. Not after death, but now, right now while living. I can comfortably say I am that free awareness, consciousness, principle without the body. This is called as Jivan Mukti. Jivan Mukti means I am free from the tyrannies of this ego I. I can still be in the waking state, have perceptions of the world without the mind disturbing me. That is what is called as freedom. If the mind keeps on throwing desires of thoughts, I like this, I don't like this, and then you go in circles, then it is called as samsara. But if you enjoy, if you see, perceive the same world, and if your mind is quiet, what happens is, you are then appreciating the world, not with reference to your likes and dislikes, raga and dvesha, but you are appreciating the entire world created by God, created by Ishvara. When you do that, it is called as Ishvara Srishti. That means a creation of the universe by the Lord for the jivas, you are able to appreciate. You look at the sun and say, wow, this sun is so beautiful. You look at the moon and say, wow, this new moon is beautiful. You look outside and say, look at the trees, look at the nature. You'll appreciate them much more as pure consciousness. This is the greatest benefit. And when we do this, what happens? We are contented. We are not, okay, we have comfort in life, which wealth, which money can bring, but we are not obsessed with the wealth. We are not really, we know that we require money, we require. But okay, I have what is required to maintain my body, maintain my family. And that, with that, I am contented. This contentment leads to fulfillment. And when you lead a life where your mind is not disturbing you too much, that is called as muktaha. Freedom. And then the scriptures, they talk about another benefit of this study of Atma. So if I learn to live this life without being drained by my mind, then what they say in the scriptures is, the mind will not take another body. When this gross body falls, the mind is attached to Atma. It is merged with Atma. There is no more rebirth after the fall of the body, which is called as in Sanskrit, Videha Mukti. So these are the two major benefits they talk in the scriptures. But the first benefit is the most important benefit for all of us, which is called as Jivan Mukti. Now we learn more about the glory of the Atma. And again, Shankaracharya starts giving examples. In this 43rd verse, he says, just as the sun rises after dispelling the darkness, the knowledge of Atma rises in us after we dispel the ignorance about Atma. So for darkness removal, knowledge, for darkness removal, light is the means. For ignorance removal about my nature, the knowledge of Atma is the means. Suppose there is a bulb which is covered, I have given this example before also, there is a bulb which is covered with a dark cloth in a dark room. If I remove the cloth, then the bulb is self-evident. You don't need another light. In fact, this bulb will illumine the whole room if I remove the dark cloth. So similarly, if I remove the ignorance which covers the Atma by the study of scriptures, by learning how to discriminate between the body, mind, and consciousness, awareness principle, what will happen is my ignorance goes away and the self-effulgent Atma is revealed. That's what is mentioned in this particular verse with an example of the sun. The next verse, verse number 44. Atma is an ever-existing reality. Here, I would like to explain to you what is the meaning of reality and what is the meaning of what is the meaning of I with Ahamkara, which is transactions. Because of ignorance, this reality which is there in this universe is not realized. And here the Shankaracharya gives another example of a missing ornament in one's neck. Suppose we are wearing a chain and then the chain gets covered by some dress which we are wearing, and then I realize I'm not wearing the chain, or by mistake I realize where is my chain. So I start looking for a chain outside and keep on searching outside, but then somebody comes and says your chain is there in your neck. Or second example is I keep a key, for example I've got a house key in my pocket. And then I search my pockets, I can't find my key of the house. Then I start looking for the key outside in the room, outside everywhere, and say, where I lost my key. And then after a lot of trouble and searching, I start sweating. And at that time, I remove my kerchief and to remove my sweat. At that time, the key falls down, which was hidden by the kerchief. So what happens in these examples is that something was covering what I already possessed. The chain I already had, but it was covered. The key I already had, it was covered. Similarly, Atma I have, it is covered by Maya. It is covered by some power in me, in this world, which is covering that pure awareness. So if I learn to remove that covering, I will discover this reality in this world. There is no distance, time-wise distance or a place-wise distance between Atma and Anatma. In the same place where my mind is, in the same place is Atma. In the same place as the body is, in the same place there is Atma. How do I say this? In the same place where the dream was, the dream world was, is the same place is the waker. In the same place as the waker is the Atma. When I don't know the security which is there in Atma, That means the peace which is there in Atma. I keep on looking at the whole universe and try to find peace in money, peace in the family, peace in business, peace in... But the world of transactions is finite. It will end. And we cannot make the finite into infinite. What the scriptures are telling us is there is peace only in when you go beyond time. In time, there is no peace because it's finite. So the teaching here is that the reality is existing, but it is covered. The peace is existing, it's covered by ignorance. I need to remove the covering and see the same peace existing in myself, in the same place. That is what is the essence of this 44th verse. The 45th verse, in all these verses, we get little glimpses of the Atma. We get different views by which we can look at the Atma. All this is only to convince our own intellect that there is something which is existing. There is something which is without this I notion. This is what this Ramana Maharishi, he brings out beautifully in his text, which is called as Sat Darshanam. I'm just digressing a little bit, just for you to know what is this reality. Because we just spoke about the reality, I thought it's good time to digress a little bit to understand what is this reality. See, this I in us exists with the I notion in the waking state. There is an I notion in us. Throughout the waking state, we have the I notion. I. All the 24 hours of the day, we have the I notion. So, there is something which is without the I notion. I exist, but without the I notion. That is called as the reality. Ramana Maharishi says, I notion, the I with the I notion, which is the waking state, the dream state, the sleep state, that ahamkara, the ego state, is not the reality. The I without the I notion is the reality. A very, very beautiful, but a very deep, you can contemplate on this, you will be able to reach the reality very, very soon. I found this verse in the Sadarshanam. Therefore, I thought I can just share it with you at this particular junction because we were talking about reality in the last verse. In the 45th verse, an example is taken again. Just as a post appears to be a ghost, Brahman appears to be a jiva because of ignorance. This is a very common example taken up in many texts of Vedanta, just to say how our mind covers the Atma. In semi-darkness, we look at a stump of a tree and then we say there is a thief instead of a stump which has been cut. Suppose a tree is cut recently and then you just see a stump like a 5 feet stump. You see it in semi-darkness, you will find that your mind is projecting something which is not there. So similarly, what he says is, Shankaracharya beautifully explains in this verse, he says that we look at our body and look at our mind in semi-darkness. Our waking state is called as the ignorance state. He says, you don't know that you are not this body and mind. Our mind in the waking state is very, 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 it comes and goes. It is not seen properly. Some thoughts, some emotions come. And then we think that we are that. So this is the superimposition which we are doing, which is the mistake. And he says that you remove this mistake, what will happen is the ego in us will be destroyed. And then the real nature of the jiva as the self, when we say the self is the same in the jiva and in the whole world. One entity. There is only one entity behind this entire world of perception, behind all the jivas, behind the entire creator also. There is only one self. That is what is the teaching, which is called as Brahman. And what is the benefit of having this knowledge of this one entity? We can do our transactions better. What I come to know that there is only one reality which is appearing as this world during the waking state, and then it goes back, the waking state goes back into that reality in the sleep state, which is what the scriptures are revealing to me as the final ultimate truth. The same one reality is appearing as the whole, as the jiva experiencer and the experienced world. Like what? Like the dream. The baker is appearing as the dreamer and the dream world. Similarly, one Brahman, one entity, one truth principle is appearing as the baker and the waking world. Very simple to understand. So if I can use that logic to understand there is one entity in this world, what will happen is I will be free from all my worries about death, about, you know, about so many problems in life. I'll say, okay, fine, these are all appearances, will come, keep coming and going. But I am free from the worries. I will not get while transacting in the world. That is the benefit which we are learning from this study, which we get from this study. The world is a field in darkness of ignorance of my own higher nature. That means my own higher nature, if I come to know, I remove the ignorance and then I can live in this world free. It's like we switch on the light of consciousness before starting our transactions. In the morning, as soon as we get up, we just tell ourselves, well, what I was in my sleep state was my real nature. Is my nature, it is my pure consciousness, pure awareness nature, which was aware of the sleep state. The sleep state is itself is not my nature. That is ignorance. The sleep state, we must be very careful when I say that what I was in my sleep state is my real nature. We must be careful to understand that the observer of the sleep state, the Sakshi principle of the sleep state, is my real nature. The sleep state by itself is an experience which is a state of inertness. I don't know myself. There is a thought. But what illumines that thought in the sleep state is the consciousness, which is what I'm referring to as my real nature. And that is called as jnanam. It is the knowledge of the real nature, of my true nature. It is not an experience, but it is the knowledge. Individuality and totality depend on this one imperishable entity, and which is ever pure. Individuality means I am Shama, I am Jacqueline, I am Ramesh, I am so and so, you know. This individuality comes only when the mind is available together with the body. But when the mind and the body is not there, I exist, that is called as the reality. And that is imperishable. This one is perishable. So individuality, ego, I is perishable. It is there for maybe 100 years, you know. It experiences a few things, but it goes away. Again, it'll come, it'll go. But I, the Atma, never comes and goes. That is the what is said in this 45th verse. The ego is destroyed when the real nature of Jiva is realized. The individuality is false. The awareness principle is the real status. The false status exists on the real status depending on it. That is why we use the word adhyaropa. Adhyaropa means superimposition. Like we superimposed on the stump of tree a thief or somebody, or like we superimpose on a rope a snake, like we superimpose on the sand a mirage water. Similarly, on Atma, we superimpose this I notion, the ego I. So first we use this, this is a methodology to reveal the Atma. The methodology is called two processes. It's got two processes. One is called a superimposition, another is negation. So when my intellect learns to superimpose, learns to see the superimposition, and my own intellect learns to negate the superimposition, then what happens is Atma, the reality, gets revealed. This is the process used by the Upanishads. So whenever in the higher text that we start doing the Upanishads, this is the process which is employed. And this is a teaching, every teacher uses this methodology. For example, I say the waking state, dream state, and the sleep state, all these three states, we describe it as being there. It exists, it appears. But every appearance has got a substratum. Like appearance of a snake has got a substratum rope. So similarly, the three states which are appearances have a substratum called as Atma. What I then do? I learn to remove the three states. I remove the rope snake, and then I see the real rope. Similarly, when I remove the three states, I see the real Atma. The removal process is called as apavada, or neti neti, or negation. So misunderstood I is the source of worry, pain, and anxiety. The understood I is the source of happiness. Understood I is called as aham, the pure awareness consciousness principle. The misunderstood I is called as ahamkara, which is also known as triputi, the knower, known, and knowledge. With this verse, I will close today's session. We have seen a few verses today, and next week we are going to start from verse number 46. And 46 to 68, there are about 23 verses. And after these 23 verses, we'll see what text we can do if you are still interested to learn more about this Atma principle. If you have any questions on these verses, which we have done today, you can type it and present it, or you can ask a question at the end of the meditation session, which we will do today as usual.